Chum dun ding wun bun jang hura yang la shang za lo. Gang ge lu zhu zhim yi zhim zhe nye de nam da rao sir vi. Chin yi dong gen chi shang su shen ni ji de kira la wang zi. Gang da zhi bi zong rin ma ri gu mun dong ding mura ji sir vi. Zhu zho gen la wu chu da jian yang la du jian yang dun song. Chu tri chi zhong ni mo ni long ni jie zha zhong zhom za chi. Marum azir dingurum yoga jenye zomza rata no, donne tajan sabjin da soyon don lizo jati tauka, chupta jodan jenye. Jantin donu mazir jangurayo landa do, omara bazanado, omara bazanado, omara bazanado, omara bazanado, omara bazanado, omara bazanado, omara bazanado. Umara bazanardı, 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 tüldün cicim ceru gözleri cildalı da mı mımbarab zani. Quadam dam ju jong lu dong ba yi lu ju hu bi no a ke de sur. Yang ji jimbo zordun niu me zhang zong ne mo lu jimbo ngal gya da pa kar dang an zan du zhe me dung ba de ji jang la zhang za lu. Ah, 各位师兄大家晚上好。
Good evening, everyone.
啊，首先请大家发菩提心。
To begin with, please everyone, arouse the mind of Bodhicitta.
简单的说，菩提心就是我们大乘佛教的修心的目标。
To put it simply, Bodhicitta is the goal of our Dharma practice.
那么我们用一句话来讲菩提心的话，那菩提心就是说。我们为了让天下所有的众生从生死轮回当中获得解脱，为了达到这个目标，首先下决心自己成佛。
So if we're going to put in one sentence what the aspiration of Bodhicitta is, it is the vow.To work for the liberation of all living beings from the sufferings of cyclic existence, and in order to attain this purpose, first achieve Buddhahood for oneself.
为了成佛，今天学习，然后呢，一步一步的修，那这样子，总有一天能一定会成佛的。而成了佛以后呢？去度众生去帮助众生这样子的决心叫做菩提心。
So in order to achieve Buddhahood, we commit ourselves to the study of Buddhism and the practice of Buddhism, and by gradually committing ourselves to this, it is sure that we will attain Buddhahood one day for ourselves, and at this point we'll be in a strong position to help other beings. And so it is this resolve or this determination that is the aspiration of Bodhicitta.
好，接下来我们讲今天的课。今天的课的题目是我们的人的身体和心灵的关系，或者是说身体和我们的意识的关系。
So we are going to move on now to the topic of this evening's teaching, which is the relationship between the body and the mind, or the body and consciousness.
我们为什么要讲这个我们的衣食和这个身体的关系呢？ 因为我们不了解我们的这个生命的真相，所以我们就对这个时节，对这个生命有很多很多的误解。那么这些误解啊，让我们产生了很多的烦恼啊，所以我们要了解一下这个真正的这个生命的本质是什么。The
reason that we are going to be talking about the relationship between the mind and the body is that we really don't know or understand the truth of existence. And given that we don't know the truth, we have a lot of misunderstandings, and these misunderstandings create a lot of agitation and suffering for us.
佛教认为，从表面上看起来，我们的身体和我们的意识之间，它虽然是有关系，但是呢，身体不是意识，意识也不是身体。那么身体和我们的这个意识，身体和意识，身体是物质，意识那就是不是物质，那么这两个。
So from a Buddhist point of view, looking at things at a surface level, it would seem that the body and mind are separate from each other, and that the body is matter and the mind is not matter.
但是如果我们深入的去了解观察的时候呢，这个我们的精神跟我们的这个身体在一个很深的这个层面上呢，也有很大的关系。也就是说，我们昨天讲过了，这个外面的物质实际上就是我们自己的心，我们自己的意识的。
However, when we probe things more deeply, Buddhism in fact reveals that at a very deep level, there is a very close and intimate connection between the body and mind. Just as we spoke of yesterday evening, external matter, that is, matter in the external world, is but a projection of our own minds, and so we can see the very close relationship in this example.
但是在现实生活当中呢，我们感觉不到这个外面的世界是我们的内心的投影，意识就是意识，身体就是身体，似乎。
However, in the course of our everyday lives, we don't really comprehend the role that the mind plays in the external world, manifesting as a projection of it. In our everyday lives, the same goes for our minds and our bodies. Our bodies are our bodies, and our minds are our minds.
佛教它 非常的忠实，这个智慧，他认为智慧可以解决我们的所有的问题，因为我们的所有的问题来自于无明，无明我们前昨天也介绍过，无明就是物质，我们对这个世界的错误的了解，我们对生命的这个错误的了解。 还有我们对生命的不了解，对物质世界的不了解等等，这些都叫做无明。
Buddhism very much prizes wisdom, and the reason for this is that wisdom is able to solve all of our problems, problems that primarily arise from ignorance. Ignorance here should be understood as the various mistaken understandings that we have to life, existence, as well as the material world as well.
所以那佛教首先让我们去了解时节啊，了解我们自己的生命啊，这个也是一种智慧。
So Buddhism encourages us to first gain an understanding of the phenomenal world as well as our own existences. This in itself is a kind of wisdom.
佛教啊，我们可以分三种佛教，一个叫做大乘佛教、小乘佛教，然后人天乘佛教啊，一共有三种不同的佛教。
It's possible to categorize the Buddhist teachings or Buddhism into three vehicles. That is the vehicle of the greater vehicle or the Mahayana path, the basic vehicle or the Hinayana path, or the worldly vehicle.
那人天佛教，那人天乘佛教是什么意思呢？就是它的要求不高啊。那就是他不需要成佛，也不需要这个成就阿罗汉啊，这些都不需要啊。那么他的追求也不是成佛，也不是啊往生西方极乐世界，也不是啊成为阿罗汉。那么他的追求是什么呢？他的追求就是这一生、下一世、再下一世啊，生生死死。能够拥有幸福的生活，那他的这个追求就这么点啊，所以呢佛教对他的要求不是很高。
So what is the worldly vehicle of Buddhism? Well, the worldly vehicle is one that doesn't place particularly high demands on us in terms of our practice. Its primary goal is not the attainment of Buddhahood, and neither is it the attainment of arhatship. Adherents of the worldly vehicle similarly don't pursue rebirth in Amitabha's pure realm. The primary concern of adherents of the worldly vehicle are positive rebirth, happy existence in this life as well as in future lives to come.
那么他的观点啊，他的见解，他的观点是什么呢？第一个啊，他的见解，他不需要证悟大圆满，他不需要证悟明心见性，不需要证悟空心啊，这些都不需要，只要相信啊，轮回，人死了以后还会投生。这样子的轮回，还有一个就是善有善报，恶有恶报，这个善恶因果，只要这两个问题解决了，就相信这两个就可以了，这就是他的观点。
In terms of the view that underpins the worldly vehicle, there is no requirement that adherents of the worldly vehicle realize the basic nature of their mind according to the Dzogchen teachings or realize emptiness. Rather, the principles or the view that they are required to embrace are a belief in past and future lives and the operation of karmic cause and effect.
我想这个人天乘就是像我们现代这个社会当中呢，可能很多人来说这个比较适合，因为他没有要求太多的修心，没有要求太多的这个打坐呀，做很多很多事情，然后呢戒律约束这些也不是很多。
It's possible that many people might say that this worldly vehicle and its goals are quite suited to people in contemporary society from the point of view that it doesn't require much practice or meditation or ethical discipline on the part of practitioners or followers.
但是他也要相信轮回，他也要相信，除了人，除了这一生以外，还有下一世。
However, it's necessary that followers of the worldly vehicle still believe in transmigration, believe in reincarnation and the operation of karmic cause and effect.
所有的佛教的观点啊，都建立在这个轮回的基础上。如果我们不接受这个轮回的观念的话，那就是没有办法去修一个真正的佛教的这个修法。
In fact, all of the Buddhist traditions are founded upon a belief or the operation of past and future lives and transmigration, and without acceptance of this, it's not possible to properly practice Buddhism.
好，接下来我们讲一讲这个人为没有前世、没有后世的这种观点我们分析一下这个观点。
So I'd like to now examine the view that past and future lives do not exist.
人死了以后呢，一切都结束就是说人的身体和人的意识是分不开的就是因为人死了以后，人的这个肉体不存在了以后呢，人的精神、人的灵魂也就随着这个精神，随着这个肉体的毁灭它也会停止。那这种观点最早它来自于什么呢？最早的时候人类最早的这个想法、人生观就是这样子的。那这个时候呢，因为这个人类的这个思维还没有那么的发达，所以他们认为一个人投生了一个人诞生了，那他认为就是一个新的生命诞生了，一个人死了，那他认为一个生命结束了，就这么简单他也不会，他没有能力去思考过去和未来。
So this view is based on a conception that when the body diesso too does the mind. That is that the body and mind are inseparable, and that when the body ceases to function, then so too does the mind. The mind follows the body, and when it finishes, the mind ceases to operate as well. Where did this thought originally arise from? In actual fact, it's a very early type of human thought, a conclusion drawn from the fact that when or a conclusion based on an idea that when a human being emerges, that life has begun, and that when a human being dies, that evidently that life has finished. So this is a viewpoint or a conclusion based on not much consideration of past and present, past and future.
那么人人类从这个远古的猿人逐渐的进化为人大概就是像智力人，就是可以站起来走路的那个前后就稍微有一点点这个思维比一般的动物那个时候还发达一点。那从那个时候呢就开始认为人没有前世，没有后世，一个生命诞生了，突然间诞生了一个生命，然后呢结束的时候呢 也就这个生命彻底的结束了。那从那个时候呢开始，人类就有一个这样子的人生观。
This viewpoint arose with very early humans or their most primitive ancestors. That is when human beings began to rise up on two legs. This idea that when a life emerged, it began, and when it died, it finished. This is a very early kind of primitive human thinking.
因为这个时候呢，他还没有能力去把人的肉体和人的精神分开来研究或者分开来讲因为他们以为人诞生的时候就是整个生命诞生了人死亡的时候呢，整个生命死亡，那么所以他们就开始有了一个这样子的想法。
And this idea or notion was due to a lack of ability of these humans to examine the physical body and the mind as separate entities. And for this reason, they were of the opinion that when a human was born, that the mind and the body together came into existence, and then when a human being died, that they both died together.
这个很简单的这个人生观，后来就是被各种各样的宗教和各种各样的哲学把它加工加工，又变成了另外一个这个人生观也就是一直延伸到今天到今天人类还有这样子的观点。
This very simplistic early human view was then elaborated on and refined by different religious traditions and philosophies, and indeed has survived in various forms until today.
人类在人类的历史上就是犯了很多很多历史，就是像这样子的错误，犯过很多这样子的错误。
And in the course of human history, we've made many mistakes of this kind of nature.
那早期的人类，他们都认为这个世界是平面的，不是像我们今天看到这样子的这个球体是平面的。
For example, early humans were all of the opinion that the world was flat. They did not know that it is round as we now know it is.
他们为什么认为这个世界是平面的呢？就是因为身高一米七的一个人身高一米六、一米七的一个人，在横拼的这个草拼草原或者是海面上往前看，他能看多远呢？就能够看到。看到4628米他就看到这个，也就是说，他很拼的这个海面上看过去，那他的地平线离他在这个4628米那个地方就是他的地平线。那除了这个以外呢，超过了这个以外，他看不见。看不见的原因呢，就是因为地球它是球体的，所以呢，再超过了以后呢，这个地球的地平线已经在它的地平线的下面，所以它看不见。
And this mistaken idea that the world was flat was due to the fact that an individual of 1.7 meters in height standing at any flat surface, whether it be on a flat plateau or at a spot on the ocean surface, looking in either direction, whether it be in front of them or behind them or to the left or right,was only able or is only able to perceive a distance in front of them or around them of up to 4,628 meters, and everything beyond this is in fact past the horizon, past which they are able to see. So despite the fact that the world is indeed spherical, this was not something they were able to perceive because they were limited in terms of the distance their eyes could perceive.
那么他往前看，也就看到这么点啊，往左、往右、往后看啊，都是这样子，嗯，都只能看到啊，四点六公里。那这样子以后呢，他觉得啊，他看到的地方呢都是平面的啊，他看到的地方都是平面。那他以为他没有看到的世界也是就像他看到的这样子，他以为。 都是平面的，所以他就下一个定义啊，说这个世界是平面的。Because
looking in either direction, in front of them, behind them, or to the left or right, a person was only able to see 4.6 kilometers. They reached the conclusion that the world was flat. They assumed that the world beyond which they were able to see was the same as the world or the topography they were able to see, and so therefore came to the conclusion that the world was flat.
这个错误跟我们刚才的这种人死了以后什么也不存在的这两种错误是特别特别相似的啊。 为什么有这样子的错误呢？这两个的犯这样子的错误的原因特别的相似。
And in actual fact, this mistake or this mistaken understanding and the mistaken understanding about human life finishing with the death of a person, both of these mistakes are in fact very similar.
比如说一个80岁的人啊，他往后看。 能够看到从第一岁到80岁，啊，也就是看到80年，嗯，再往前看的话，他也许还可以活10年、20年这样子的时间，啊，那他也可以看到，往前就是未来，啊，他可以看到啊预测到10年、20年，啊，那么10年、20年以后的事情呢，他没办法预测，然后呢？ 80年以前的事情呢，就是也就是说他还没有诞生之前的这个生命，他是什么呢？他也不知道啊，所以他就觉得生命就这么100岁之前啊，之前的80年之后的20年加起来就是100年，他认为生命就这一点啊，除了这个以前和以外的啊，因为他没有看见，所以他觉得不存在。
We can take the example of an 80-year-old person. Looking back or reflecting back, they are able to reflect from themselves at 1 year of age up until their present stage at 80 years of age, and then projecting into the future. It's possible they might live for another 10 or 20 years, so they're able to project in front of them that far. Insofar as projecting beyond this, they're not able to do this, and going back beyond when they were born, this is something that they have no knowledge of. So based on this limited time frame, that is the 80 or perhaps 100 years that they can fathom their life as being, they take this to be be what human life is, and this definition or conclusion that they draw is based on not being able to see or understand further into the past or further into the future.
然后就全世界的人几百年前啊，所有的人都认为太阳从东边啊升起的时候呢，从每一天从东边升起，从西边落，这样子以后呢。 大家都认为太阳啊绕着我们转啊，那他们不知道，因为这个太阳从东边升起的时候啊，这个地平线在下降啊，然后呢，太阳往西边落的时候呢， 地平线的上升啊，那这些他都不知道不明白，所以他就有一个下一个定义，然后说啊，我们就是宇宙的中心啊，所有的太阳、月亮、所有的星星都绕着我们转。
And similarly, centuries ago, people were of the view that when the sun rose in the east and set in the west, that this was indicative of the fact that the sun, in fact, rotated around the world. They didn't understand how the descending horizon and the elevating horizon indicated otherwise. So based on this, people thought that the Earth was at the center of the whole universe.
那这类的错误啊，曾经犯过很多很多。那么其中有一部分呢，我们现在已经知道是我们错了。那有一部分比较深奥的一些东西呢，到目前还没有。还不知道这个是错误的观点。
So mistakes of this kind are very numerous in the course of human history, and some of them we are now aware are mistakes or were mistakes. However, there are many such mistaken notions or understandings that we are yet to become aware of that we are yet to understand are in fact mistaken in nature.
好，接下来我们再介绍一下啊，佛教的这个心和身的这个关系方面的观点。
So I'd like to talk about now the Buddhist perspective on the relationship between mind and body.
佛教认为，我们的意识啊，就像一只鸟。我们的身体呢，就像一棵树那么这只鸟可以在这个树在这个树上停留，但是呢它到了一定的时候呢，它可以离开这棵树，然后它又可以选择另外的一棵树。
So, Buddhism regards the mind as being like a bird and the body as being like a tree. And it's possible for the bird to perch on the branch of a tree and stay there for a while, but it's also possible for the bird to leave the tree and to eventually find another tree to perch on.
还有讲啊，佛教讲我们的身体呢，就像一个壳仔。然后我们的医师就像一个客人啊，那客人他暂时会停留在这个客栈，但是呢，到一定他该走的时候呢，他会离开这个客栈。
Another metaphor that we use is that the body is like a guest house or an inn, and the mind or consciousness is like a guest. It's possible for the guest to dwell in the inn for a period of time, but it is also the fact that there will be one day when the guest does leave.
所以啊，身体的毁灭不能说明意识的这个意识，或者是我们的生命的结束。
So from the Buddhist point of view, the end of the human body does not mean the end of life.
好，那么这个我们怎么来证明呢？这个说法怎么来证明啊？有没有什么方法可以证明呢？有很多啊，比如说佛教里面的一些修行啊，修行的方法、训练的方法，它可以亲身可以体会到的。但是呢，我们今天给大家介绍一个大家都能够比较容易接受的一个另外一个方法。
So is there any way that we can go about proving this theory, proving this idea? There are ways in Buddhism. There are different methods of practice that enable us to verify this theory very clearly. However, tonight what I would like to introduce to everyone is a very simple and accessible way that we can go about verifying this theory.
虽然科学家说我们的意识是从大脑的细胞产生。
Even though scientists say that our mind or consciousness arises from the brain or is generated by our neurons.
科学家为什么这么说呢？就是因为我们人有情绪的时候比如说痛苦、快乐或者是其他的这个情绪有了这样子的情绪的变化的时候呢，然后我们的大脑的脑电波有变化有变化，所以科学家发现这两个有一定的这个关系，所以有大部分的科学家就是说我们的意识实际上就是大脑的产物，实际上就是一个大脑的运动而已除了这个以外没有别的这个意识。
And why is it that science upholds this view? Scientists observed that when we experience emotions, whether they be of happiness or suffering or of other natures, that is when there are changes in our emotional state that the brain waves change as well. And so through observing this, they posited that the mind is but a process or a result of brain activity.
但是这个不是所有的科学家的观点，这是目前主流科学家的观点是这样的，但是呢，有一部分的神经科学家甚至是这个诺贝尔奖的获得者，有几个他们觉得这样子去解释这个过于太简单，这个脑电波的这个变化没有办法完全去解释我们的这个意识。
Whilst this is the viewpoint of mainstream science, it is not a viewpoint that is upheld by all scientists. In fact, there are some scientists, including a Nobel Prize winner, who are of the view that explaining mind as generated through brain activity or as simply a form of brain activity is an incomplete account.
虽然佛教跟这个科学虽然有非常非常多的相同的地方，但是呢，在这个问题上佛教也觉得，我从佛教的角度来看，那这样子解释确实是过于简单这样子解释是没有解释不了意识的本质。
Even though there are many points of overlap and commonalities between Buddhism and science in terms of this question, that is mainstream science's understanding of the mind. Buddhism regards this understanding, this current understanding at any rate, as overly simplistic and ultimately unable to explain mind and unable to explain consciousness.
主要有两个问题第一个问题呢，目前科学家对大脑也不是完全的了解，还有很多很多不了解的，所以呢这个时候大脑还本身它是什么样子都不了解，所以这个时候说意识是它的产物，还没有没有很强的证据。
The first problem is that, or weakness is that we don't yet have a complete understanding of the brain and brain processes. So in order to say that consciousness or mind is a product of the brain, this is a rather premature conclusion.
更重要的就是目前还科学家还根本不知道 我们的意识怎样从身心缘啊诞生啊？那身心缘如果诞生的话，那这个有一个过程啊，怎么样我们的意识从我们的大脑的神经元诞生啊，那应该有一个很确切的证据，但是目前根本就没有，根本就不知道怎么样诞生的，只不过没有找到更合适的这个啊更合适的解释，但暂时就是看到了一个情绪跟这个脑电波的变化，看到了这个关系啊，只是看到了这个关系就去这样子解释。
The second major weakness in the mainstream explanation is that although it claims that consciousness or mind is generated by neurons in the brain, so far there isn't a convincing account of the process by which this takes place. And if indeed it is the case that mind is produced by neurons, then we should be able to arrive at a very clear and convincing account of the exact process by which this takes place. So given the fact that this is currently the mainstream viewpoint, it is so only as a default position that is a mainstream opinion given a current lack of an alternative satisfactory explanation. So the conclusion that the mind is produced by neurons is simply based on observing changes in the brain waves linked to changes in human emotional states.
好，这种说法充其量也只能这个我们的意识跟大脑有一个关系而已，只能说明这一点，根本就没有办法，因为有这样子的关系，所以我们的意识是大脑，那这样子解释，这种态度确实是不太科学。
In fact, what scientists have observed so far is only enough to support an argument that the mind and the brain have a connection. That is to say that they have a relationship. What we have observed so far is not sufficient to support a conclusion that the mind is the product of the brain.
比如说一只鸟在一棵树上的时候，这个树风动摇的时候呢，那这个树上的鸟也会跟着这个树会动的啊，然后这个鸟在树叶上树枝上活动的时候呢，因为它的运动也会动摇这个树枝啊，但是呢就这么一点的这个原因，我们不能说这个鸟，这只鸟是这棵树，或者是这棵树就是这只鸟啊，不能这样子解释。
With using the example of the bird on the tree, the bird perched on the tree's branch. When the wind blows and the branch sways, then the bird moves as the branch sways. And similarly, if the bird jumps up and down on the branch, then the tree will also move as a result of the bird's movement. But based on just these two things, not sufficient to say that the bird is the product of the tree or the tree is the product of the bird.
那么佛教看啊，大脑跟我们的意识它到底是什么关系呢？大脑就是它的工具大脑就是意识的工具然后呢意识呢通过大脑来看外面的这个，来感受外面的世界那么它的工具也是眼耳鼻舌身，也是它的工具，但是呢眼耳鼻舌身的一个主要的东西呢就在大脑里面这个藏传佛教的密宗里面呢讲得非常清楚的，还有藏传佛教的这个藏医医学里面呢也讲得非常清楚的。
So, what How does Buddhism then understand the relationship between brain and consciousness? Buddhism regards the brain as being a tool of consciousness, that is, a tool through which it experiences the external world. So this means that the sense consciousnesses are also the tool of the mind. And the way that this works or this relationship is explained or is given a very clear account of in Vajrayana scriptures and as well as in Tibetan medicine.
大脑啊的某一个部分出问题的时候呢，我们也许看不见，也许听不见啊，也许身体没有知觉，失去知觉都有可能啊。那为什么呢？因为我们的意识它就是缺乏了这些工具，所以它没有办法去感知外面的世界。
It's possible that when a part of our brain is injured that we are no longer able to see, to perceive images, or we're no longer able to feel. And this is because the part or the tool that our consciousness relies on to experience these phenomena is injured. And when this part of the brain is injured or when different parts of the brain is injured, then consciousness is without the tools that it relies on to perceive the external world.
比如说、啊、有一位画家他用毛笔、啊、画画，那么画家、啊、就像意识，好比是意识、啊、然后呢他的笔就是好比是他的大脑、啊、那么画家他知道这个画怎么画、啊、但是如果他没有笔他没办法画画、啊、同样的意识、啊、他要靠大脑，然后呢再靠这个感官去感知，去感受外面的世界，所以他缺乏了这些工具以后呢，他没有办法去感受外面的世界，就这么简单。
So it's just like an artist painting a picture. The artist uses a brush to paint a picture on a surface. We can liken the artist to consciousness and the brush to brain. That is to say that the artist his or herself knows how to paint the picture. However, without the brush, it's not possible for them to execute this idea or to manifest a picture on the surface. So too, it is with our consciousness. Without our brain and without our sense consciousnesses, it is not possible for the consciousness to experience the external world. And this is how it operates very simply.
还有一个啊，就是如果我们说大脑跟这个啊我们的意识是一个东西，这么去结识的话，那就有一个很大的问题，是什么问题呢？就是有一个叫做脑外记忆啊，就是除了我们大脑以外的记忆啊，那是什么呢？就是小比如说两岁的小孩啊，他能够回忆他的过去啊，这类的叫做脑外记忆。
There's another phenomenon that challenges the idea that the brain and consciousness are one and the same, and this phenomenon is that of out of brain memory, or memory that functions outside of the brain. So an example of this would be a two-year-old child who has memory or recollection of their previous life.
那么小孩记忆前世这个可不可靠呢？这绝对是可靠的。
Is the recollection of a two-year-old child of their previous life?Reliable. Yes, it is absolutely reliable.
为什么说绝对可靠呢？这个有很多的这个理由第一个，2500多年前就有小孩2岁3岁的时候，他就能够 及以啊他的上一世的这些生活的细节啊。那佛经上面呢，有释迦牟尼佛的年代就出现过这样子的事情啊。那么2500多年前有，那今天也有，1000多年前也有。那么这种现象在人类的历史上从来没有间断过，一直都有，一直都有。
And why do I claim that this is absolutely reliable? What are there in fact reasons or grounds for this claim? There are examples of children of 2 or 3 years of age who were able to remember their past lives are documented as early as 2,500 years ago during the time of the Shakyamuni Buddha. So not only do we have accounts of young children who were able to remember their lives this long time ago, but accounts of this nature still exist today. And so this phenomenon has existed in human history in an unbroken way for several millennia.
然后它的范围啊，也不是这个某一个地区和某一个民族里面啊，这个地球上除了南极洲以外，所有的其他洲上面都有这样子的这个这样子的事情，小孩记忆前世的事情。
And the scope or the area. In which these accounts have emerged from is not limited to one particular area or one particular ethnicity. In fact, accounts of young children who are able to remember their past lives have been found on every single continent, every single part of the world, with the exception of Antarctica.
那么南极洲啊，为什么没有这样子的事情呢？就是因为目前还没有人去调查。没有人去考察，所以还没有发现啊。其他都东南西北都有。
And perhaps the reason that we haven't got any accounts from Antarctica yet is that no one has sought to research this. However, from every other part of the world, we have accounts of children being able to recollect past lives.
尤其是啊，就是从上世纪50年代的时候就开始去研究就是研究以科学的态度去研究这种现象，都是维吉尼亚大学的史蒂文森先生和他的团队他就在半个世纪当中全世界的范围做了各种各样的调查，通过科学的态度去调查，那么他们的手里现在有非常多的证据。
And in particular, beginning in the 1950s, a research group based at the University of Virginia under the leadership of Professor Stevenson commenced research into this phenomenon along the lines of scientific principles, and they, in fact, have been able to collect a great amount of data.
那他的团队的手里目前有2500多个个案。
The number of individual cases that they've been able to collect up until today, is 2,500.
然后史蒂文森先生他写过很多书关于这方面他的这个研究的报告。
And Stevenson, Professor Stevenson himself, has authored many reports and books about this research.
然后他2007年的时候，他去世了。那他的团队到现在还在研究。那么他的团队的其他人写的书也有好几本。
Professor Stevenson himself passed away in 2007. However, other members of his research group are still continuing this research and themselves have produced several volumes.
他的报告啊，他研究的报告大家看过没有？
I don't know whether or not anyone has seen any of their research.
有多少人看过？举个手，我们看看。
Raise your hand if you have seen this research.
Oh.不多
，not so many，
只有10%的人 可能7%的人看，好像不到7%，只有5%的人看过。
Seems only about 5% of us have seen this research.
我想啊，他们的这个调查，他的报告确实是非常有意思的。
I'm of the view that their research is in fact very, very interesting, very compelling.
15年前啊，我也在藏区好几个地方就调查过这样子的小孩。
15 years ago in Tibet, I also interviewed many young children who recollected details of previous lives.
那么。史蒂文森他们的团队现在呢，专门针对美国的这个小孩在做调查。
Stevenson's research group is primarily focused on the experiences or the recollections of young children from America.
他们目前通过电话、通过网络调查，他们说基本上平均每一个星期就收到两个左右的这个。这样子的这个个案。
And they said that they within the every week they receive either by phone or via the internet reports of two such cases, two reports afforded to them.
当然了，这个当中呢，也许有啊，也许有错误的啊，也许有不可靠的信息啊，有的。但是呢，这些不，我们不能因为有一个两个不可靠的或者错误的，就把全盘的否定。
Of course, it's possible that within these reported cases, there are those that are unreliable and those that are mistaken. However, we can't dismiss the entirety of their data based on the existence of several unreliable or mistaken accounts.
在东方啊，中国历史上也有这样子的文献，到现在也可以查得到。
And in Chinese history, there was also documentation of these similar kinds of phenomenon, and it's still possible to consult these historical documents.
不管这个在东方也好，西方也好。这个就这么长的这个人类历史上啊，都不断的发生的一个事情。
Regardless of whether it's Asian society or in the West, in fact, human history has seen a constant stream of reports of this nature.
所以这个我们这个问题没有办法回避，没有办法去逃避。
So, in fact, this phenomenon is not one that we can dismiss.
必须要有一个客观公正的态度去面对。
In fact, it is one that we need to approach in an objective and impartial way.
那么明年啊，去年五月份的时候，我也跟这个史蒂文森先生的这个团队的人交流过。那么他们的。到目前啊，他们的观点是什么呢？他们说，除了这个轮回转世以外，没有一个合理的解释。
Last year in May, I had the opportunity to meet with members of Stevenson's research group and to have a conversation with them about their research. And what they claimed is that aside from the operation of reincarnation, that is past and future lives, a consciousness that spans more than one existence, there is no other compelling explanation that they know of.
那这种现象啊，不管是在过去、现在、东方、西方啊，不管是在什么地方啊，比如说在藏区或者是在其他的地方啊，那么。这个规律它就有一个自然的规律都是一模一样的啊。比如说小孩两岁的时候刚刚会说话的时候呢他记得特别的清楚啊，讲得特别的准然后呢到了7、8岁的时候呢 慢慢慢慢的胆滑就忘掉了。这个我调查的那些小孩也都是这样子。那么史蒂芬森他们在全球范围调查的绝大多数都是这样子。
Of all of these cases of children who can remember or recollect their past lives, there is a constant pattern that emerges, and that is one whereby children at approximately 2 years of age are able to give accounts of their past life with great clarity and precision, but their ability to recollect and remember becomes increasingly weak and then finally disappears at approximately 7 or 8 years of age. This was the case also among the children that I interviewed in Tibet, and it is the pattern that has been exhibited in the research findings of the group in Virginia, so this would seem to be a global pattern that operates.
所以这个里面呢，绝对有一个自然的规律。
So we could say that actually the recollection of past lives exhibits a natural pattern.
不是人为的，如果是人为的，物中生有这样子的话，那为什么全世界的这类的小孩他们的这些基本的这些规律，为什么都是一样呢？
If in fact this was something that was specific to a particular area, then how would it be the case that all children in all over the world from completely different places remember and recollect their past lives in the same way?
所以这个就是这么几千年的这个人类历史，全球范围就这么大的范围内发生的一个生命的现象，一个生命的自然现象，所以这个我们不能忽略，这个不能不揭示。
So this is an example of a phenomenon related to human existence and human life that has occurred over several thousand years in places all over the world, and it's not one that we are able to account for very easily.
因为这个对我们了解自己的生命，或者是我们了解这个生命，从这个角度来讲，这个确实是一个非常非常重要的事情。所以我希望大家去关注一下去了解一下或者是去研究一下，我们可以这些史蒂芬森先生的这些书，网上也有，现在目前有中文版、英文版都有。
Because this phenomenon, in fact, is very important to our understanding of human life and human existence, I would be really glad if everyone could pay attention to their research and read their books. The books that they have published are available now online in both Chinese and in English.
然后我个人调查的这些也 都在网上，我可以负责任的说，这里面的每一句话都是真实的。
And the research that I personally conducted is also available online, and I can verify vouch that every single sentence in these books are completely reliable.
好，这个就是还有一个更加的不容易揭示的是什么呢？比如说史蒂芬森他们的这个调查当中呢，也有这个情况我在藏区也遇到了好几个这样子的。那比如说他上一世他在战争当中死亡，然后呢他的身体的某一个地方受伤因此就死亡。那么下一世他会能够回忆他当时的所有的这些细节然后呢有一个更加的不可思议的呢，就是不可思议的现象他上一世这个受伤的这个地方下一世的身体就有伤疤 啊，不是胎记，不是一般的胎记，就是有伤疤啊。那这个除了这个以外，没有任何的其他的解释。
In connection with this, there is an even more astounding phenomenon, and that is cases where a person who received an injury in a previous life, that is a wound to their body or a wound to their skin, is in their next life able to recall the details of their injury. And even more astounding than this is the fact that their body in fact has a scar on it in the same place that they were wounded in a previous life. And this is a real scar or a real mark, not simply just a birthmark.
那么这种现象啊，一千五六百年前的佛教的这个书籍上面呢，记得清清楚楚的，有这样子的现象，而且佛教有它的解释。
This phenomenon is in fact recorded in Buddhist scriptures dating back to 1,500 years ago, and not only is there documentation of this phenomenon, but an explanation is also given.
然后史蒂文森他们的团队收集了很多很多这方面的资料，他们也拍了很多很多的照片。
And the research group under Professor Stevenson also did a lot of research into this and took many photos of cases where this had happened.
那么大家想想啊，我们的上一世的这个身体啊，即使是我们有下一世、上一世啊，那上一世的身体呢，就是归土，变成了尘土。啊，那么下一世的我们的这个身体呢，就是因为父母的这个痉挛就新诞生的一个身体。那么这两个当中有什么关系呢？
This is something that we can really think about. How can it be that the body of our past life when we die it goes to dust, and then the new body that we receive in our next life is the result of the meeting of our mother's egg and our father's sperm. That is, it's a completely new body that arises. So what can the connection be between the body in a past life and the body we have in this current life?
那么史蒂文森先生的他的解释是什么呢？他认为，比如说上一世受伤的时候呢，因为身体受伤了，他的精神特别的去关注他的这个疼痛啊，特别的去关注，所以呢下一世的时候就是变成了，因为他的心理的作用，下一世的这个投胎有这个胎记。那也许一部分的问题是可以这样子解释，但是这个解释不是很全面。
Stevenson's account of this phenomenon explained itby saying that the wound that reappeared on the body of the person in their future life came about due to the mind paying attention or being very concerned, very focused on the suffering connected to this wound, and therefore the reemergence of the wound was a psychosomatic consequence of the fixation on suffering in the previous life.
因为没有疼痛的，比如说上一世的他的身体上打了某一种记号，那有些时候在下一世的这个能够记忆上一世的小孩身上可以找到啊一种特殊的胎记，但是他是没有这种疼痛的这种感受，所以呢不仅仅是因为这个疼痛的原因，他有其他的原因。
However, there are cases when marks on a person's body re-emerge that are not connected with circumstances of suffering, and so therefore we can't say that suffering itself and the fixation of the mind on it is a complete explanation for this.
在藏区啊，我调查的这些当中呢，也有一个这样子，这些都是千真万确的事实啊。 如果这个是一个无中生有的话，那我们刚才讲的一样，为什么2000多年前就有？为什么今天也有？为什么翻覆的有？然后为什么全球的范围都有？为什么全世界这么多人去撒谎？他们的目的是什么？他们想达到什么样的目标？没有理由，都是一个真实的现象。
If these phenomenon was without foundation, then why is it the case that we have documented history of it for such a long period of time? And not just a long period of time, but in all parts of the world, among peoples in every part of the earth. Why would it be that people across the ages and in many different places would all tell lies about this? What would their purpose in doing so be?
在人类历史上，真正的这个前世后世的这种完整的概念，是从释迦牟尼佛开始建立的。
In the course of human history, a complete account or a complete explanation, a comprehensive explanation of past and future lives, transmigration began with the Shakyamuni Buddha.
那释迦牟尼佛成佛了以后呢，他获得了这个超级的智慧，那以这个智慧来观察人类生命的这个现象的时候呢，佛就发现原来我们的肉体跟精神它不是一个东西啊。在之前啊，历史上很多人有持有这种观点，这个就是因为那个时候的人类的思维还不成熟，还没有达到这个境界，所以他们没有能力去把人的精神和意识分开讲啊，那是这个原因。所以佛啊，他发现这是一个错误的观念，然后佛就发现啊，原来我们的身体是可以这个暂时毁灭，但是我们的精神啊，它是永远都不会毁灭，它可以一直啊，都一直都可以比如说我们就是一只鸟，从一只树然后再搬迁到另外一只树上一样，我们的这个意识呢，可以换很多很多的身体。
When the Buddha attained enlightenment, he gained a transcendent wisdom, and this enabled him to perceive that the way that humans had conceived of the relationship between mind and body up until this point had in fact been mistaken. That is, the idea that mind and body were inseparable was something the Buddha was able to see as a mistake. He was able to perceive that in fact, the mind or consciousness is something that continues perpetually, whereas and occupies or resides in different bodies. Similar to the bird on the tree, it's possible for a bird to perch in one tree, but also to leave it and move to many other trees.
就是关于这个轮回啊方面呢，我也有一本书，那么这个当中呢也引用了一些史蒂芬森先生他们的研究的报告。
My own book that I've published about my research into this phenomenon has also makes reference to several research reports that were published by Stevenson's team。
然后就是我详细的记录了我自己调查的这些全部的这些内容也在那个里面。
And in this book, I give an extremely detailed account of my research findings.
还有佛教对这个的描述，还有佛教的观点都在这本书里面。
And in this book, I also present the Buddhist explanation of this phenomenon as well.
这些都是我们在生活当中确确实实发生的事情，所以我们不能忽略。
These things or such phenomenon are ones that really take place in our lives and in our world, and so we can't afford to dismiss them.
那么这是我们的生活当中发生的这个活生生的这样子的例子，这个是没有办法，也实际上也是没有办法再忽略。这是一个活生生的例子，这些都是活生生的例子，所以这个没办法忽略的。
Because it is a real live example of something that has taken place, we simply can't dismiss it.
这些都在讲，这些都在透露，一个人类的一个生命的真相。
And all of these involve understanding the truth of human existence.
所以我们的生命是可以延续的。
So we can say that a life is able to be continued, that is, it is continuous in its nature.
科学家讲物质不灭，其实除了物质以外，精神也是一样，精神也是不灭的，物质不灭，精神也是不灭。
So, scientists argue that matter is indestructible. We can also say that consciousness is the same, that consciousness is also indestructible. It's possible to talk about the indestructibility of them both.
什么是物质不灭？比如说，这朵花三天以后，它这朵花有可能，就慢慢的老了。然后最后就是变成了土，这个它的颜色、它的形状、它的这个形式，不存在，它的外形不存在。但是呢，就是构成这朵花的原子、分子，这些细微的东西呢，它不会因此而结束，它永远都会存在。
An example of the indestructibility of matter would be this flower. In several days' time, this flower may decompose into the earth, and so we would no longer have the form of the flower, its appearance, its color, etc. However, the molecules and atoms that comprise this flower would still exist.
这个构成这朵花的这个原子和分子，那么它现在是以一朵花的形式出现在我们的眼前它有可能两年以后呢，以另外一种一个砖头或者是另外一种的形式出现在我们的眼前。
So these atoms and molecules which take today the appearance of a flower may very well in several years' time take on the appearance or the form of a brick.
同样的，我们的意识我们的意识，我们的生命现在以一个人的身份出现在这个地球上有可能五十年以后呢，我们的这个生命以另外一种人，或者是另外一种动物，另外一种生命的形式出现在这个地球上。
So we can say it's the same with our consciousness. Right now, today, our consciousness appears in the form of a human, but it is possible that in another 50 years or so that our consciousness may appear in another life form, such as that of an animal.
那么这朵花的原子分子有可能三年以后以一个马铃薯的形式出现在我们的眼前，这叫做物质不灭。
So that the atoms and molecules that constitute this flower today may in 3 years' time take on the form and appearance of a potato is an example of the indestructibility of matter.
那我们的生命和我们的意识有可能五十年以后呢， 也许以一个动物的身份出现在这个地球上，这叫做生命不灭。
And that, our human forms that we currently occupy may, in 50 years' time, our consciousness may take on the form of an animal or another life form, is an example of the indestructibility of consciousness.
然后呢？我们这个意识跟我们的这个身体，他们在一起的时候呢，它虽然不是，意识不是我们的身体，我们的身体不是意识，但是呢，它们之间有密切的关系。
So even though when our mind or our consciousness and our body are together, they are not, one and the same thing. That is, our mind is not our body, and our body is not our mind. Nevertheless, there is a very close and intimate connection between the two.
比如说我们的大脑，我们的身体的某一个部分受到影响的时候呢，我们的精神也会受到影响。
Such as, when a part of our body, is made contact with or is injured in some way, then our mind also is influenced or is affected in some way.
比如说安眠药、镇定剂、还有这个麻醉药等等、通过这些药物对我们的身体的这个刺激、然后呢通过这个最后、我们的精神意识也就受到影响，他感觉不到、这个、这些感受。
So an example would be, when we take different kinds of medicine, such as sleeping pills or suppressants of different kinds or anesthesia, that these medicines first, affect our body, and as a result of this, our minds are also affected. That is, they cease to be able to perceive things as they previously did.
还有、我们的意识同样也可以影响到我们的身体、医学上有一个新的名词、有一个新的名词叫做性神疾病、性神疾病、大家注意一下、这个中文里面的神性疾病和性神疾病是不一样的、神性疾病、神体的神放在前面、那变成什么样的疾病呢？比如说因为身体的变化，就是精神受到了变化、精神就受到了影响，比如说像老年痴呆症、这样子叫做肾性疾病。
There is a word or a new term that is psychosomatic illness. This word, which is made up of two compounds in Chinese, the compound for body and the compound for mind, depending on the order that these two compounds are placed in, can mean different things. So if we say body-mind illness, then this refers to a sickness or an illness where a change in our physical bodies then creates some kind of manifestation in the mind or illness in the mind. And an example of this would be Alzheimer's disease.
然后性肾疾病、这个性字放在前面，肾字放在后面的时候呢，那它是另外一种疾病、那是什么疾病呢？不是因为身体受到影响，最后就是意识的变化、就是因为意识，我们的意识现、受到了、这个有了，首先受到了外界的影响，比如说焦虑、担忧、抑郁等等这样子的变化，然后通过意识在、把我们的身体受到了影响，最后就身体、这个生病，这个病、不仅仅是抑郁症，有太多太多的病，大家可以 查一查医学字典啊的这个病特别特别的多，心脏病啊、胃肠啊各方面都有可能导致这种病。
Psychosomatic illness, however, and this is rendered in Chinese with the mind character in front of the body character, is one where a manifestation of our mind then leads to the manifestation of physical symptoms of illness. So an example would be emotions or feelings of anxiety, worry or depression, then giving rise to physical symptoms of disease in the body. And it is possible that all of the organs of our body, heart disease, liver disease, and disease of other organs can be affected in this way. That is, they can manifest illness as a result of a psychosomatic process.
好，然后修心的时候呢，我们通过身体啊修心，最后净化我们的心灵也是可以的。比如说密宗里面的七脉明点的修法，实际上是身体的修法，但是呢，最后可以把内心当中的烦恼也可以断除。
It's also there are also practice methods within Buddhism to refine our minds or to work on our minds, to train our minds using methods that primarily work at the level of the body. So in the Vajrayana tradition, the practice of meditation on winds, drops and channels, this is a practice that works at the level of the body to ultimately affect change in the mind.
好，然后通过心灵的这个训练，通过心灵的训练，通过精神的训练，也可以净化我们的身体。比如说藏传佛教的修大圆满的时候呢，因为通过他的正悟，然后身体缩小啊，或者是说，比如说藏传、汉传都有的，比如说正悟了明心见性以后呢，整个的这个身体啊变成了舍利子啊等等啊，这个大家都比较了解的，所以呢，我们的身体可以影响到我们的精神，精神同样也可以影响到我们的身体。
So just as it is possible for our body to influence our mind, it is also possible for our mind to impact upon our body. So, for example, in Buddhism, in practices such as Dzogchen, through training our minds, it is possible to refine or to transform our physical bodies, such as in meditation practices where the body of an advanced practitioner shrinks after death, or other examples of advanced meditation practice where practitioners achieve the highest levels of realization, and then after their deaths, their bodies transform into many relics and particles. There are many examples of this.
好，我现在我们今天晚上我讲的这个课的内容，我再总结一下，归纳一下啊。科学讲物质不灭，佛教讲除了物质以外，我们的生命和精神也不灭。
So I'd just like now to recap briefly what we've spoken about this evening. The first point is that as science talks about the indestructibility of matter, in Buddhism we say that aside from this, it is also possible to talk about the indestructibility of life and consciousness.
好，因为时间的关系，我们今天的课就讲到这里，希望大家进一步的去多了解一下这方面的这些有关的相关的资料，还有研究的这些报告。
Due to the fact that we are out of time tonight. We can't go on any further with this at this moment, but I hope that everybody avails themselves of the research that has been published into the kinds of things we've been talking about.
好，我们最后做一个回乡啊，我们今天啊，讲经说法、听经闻法，这个有很大的功德。我们把这个功德分享给天下所有的众生，愿我们的功德能让天下所有的众生暂时能心服快乐，很快就能够了脱生死啊！以这样子的心愿来回向。
So we are now going to dedicate the merit from tonight's teaching to share it with all living beings with the wish that they enjoy temporary happiness and health and very quickly, as soon as possible, are able to be liberated from the sufferings of cyclic existence.
So nam dayi tamja zubha nya to ne ni be jana ba je.揭伽那揭瓦隆遮巴遮本佐林遮瓦遮瓦修阿摩阿吽班赞格遮巴玛瑟德吽阿摩阿吽班赞格遮巴玛瑟德吽Om Aum Benzangar Bama Sudhum
谢谢谢谢大家阿弥陀佛大家晚安